Okay, I think we're ready. All right, hello everyone. Welcome to the I Love Jeet Kune Do broadcast number 49. And this one, I didn't even pull up my Facebook page. This one is the one about, to me, JKD is like fill in the blank, right? So we'll get to the reason for that title. So as you guys are logging in, please say where you're logging in from, and you know the drill, hit the like button, algorithmic relevance and all that good stuff, right? Okay, so the one about, to me, JKD is like fill in the blank. So this is awkward to a certain degree because it's one of those subjective, existential, philosophical JKD questions or topics which are a little bit challenging, especially if you're sitting here talking to people on the camera, right? So I'm not going to be offended if I lose a whole bunch of you during the broadcast, because this is honestly, this is one of those topics that's probably like a Jeet Kune Do discussion that's probably best engaged in live, you know, face to face, right? Which gave me an idea, and I'm gonna see if sometime in the near future we can actually have revisit this topic. To me, JKD is like fill in the blank, and then we'll have a whole bunch of people. I'll bring a whole bunch of people on screen with me time after time. Hello, Kurt. Hello, Ruben. Ruben, I don't call you by your old UMAA nickname anymore because you're a grown up guy. You're an adult now. So, all right. So, to me, JKD is like fill in the blank. You know how there's this rule that there are certain topics that you don't discuss, you know, like politics and sex and religion and money and what have you, right? Because people tend to disagree on those things a lot. So you could follow that rule, or you could be like me and rebel against it, right? And actually make those things, because they're important facets of life, you could make those things topics of discussion, right? Because I'm not really big on people telling me what I can and cannot do, right? So, like, if you start with religion, right? You know, essentially in religion, you have the beginning of the movement, then you have the leader or the leaders appear, and then maybe the leader or the leaders, they pass on, and then the followers begin to do the preaching. And then that's when the separations, right, the differences in opinion and the differences in thought, that's when those things appear, right? So we could do today's entire broadcast on the JKD / religion connection, right? Or if you stop and think about it, Jeet Kune Do is a lot like politics, right? Ruben's on here, so this is a good one, right? If you take all the parties in this country, you know, you got the Republicans, you got the Democrats, you got the Independents, you got the Progressive, you got the Libertarians, you got this and that, right? I think it's fair to say that everybody pretty much has peace and prosperity and the pursuit of happiness for all Americans as their ultimate goal, right? But they have different ideas and different approaches on how that can be achieved. So likewise, in Jeet Kune Do, everybody's goal is pretty much combat proficiency and self-development and what have you, but the different groups have different ideas and different approaches on how that is achieved. So we could do an entire broadcast on how JKD is like politics, right? But I chose to fill in the blank with music. So to me, Jeet Kune Do is like music. So the origin story, right? Like I said, Ruben's on here, and Ruben trained with me back in the days for a number of years. So he knows a little bit about the musical influences and what have you. So indulge me for a second while I give you the background on this. The origin story, because I always like to tell you guys what the origin story is, right? It's from a discussion, a mini discussion about Sting's debut solo album, right, called The Dream of the Blue Turtles, right? So I gotta tell you why this album holds a place in my heart. The album was recorded in Barbados while I still lived in Barbados at Eddie Grant's studio. And when he came down to Barbados to record the album, Sting traveled under his name, Gordon Sumner, and he traveled down on the same flight that I was on, right? I sat up front, he sat in the back, but he traveled under his real name, so nobody knew who he was until he got off. But the better part about that is that when the drums came in for Omar Hakim, and so Ruben is somebody who could tell you that I am a little bit into percussion and what have you, right? Omar Hakim is one of my favorite drummers of all times. And when the drums came in, they came in on my airline. They came in on Eastern, and I was working at Air Freight that particular morning, so I got to touch Omar Hakim's drums and load them, right? But it's not really the album that is the big thing for me. The big thing really came 2 years later, because I think the album was released in 83, but in 85 there was a documentary made by Michael Apted, and it was called Bring On the Night. So this documentary came out in 85. So in 85 I had 2 years in with Sifu and Asano, right? And there is a scene in the documentary where Mr. Sumner is asked about a difference between rock music that he was known for and jazz, which was what he was kind of embarking on with that album. And he said words to the effect that in jazz, when you play a solo, you're allowed to go down certain avenues and try out different things, and then you can jettison certain ideas as you build the solo. He says, but compared to rock music, in rock music, when you take a solo, you gotta burn right from the start, right? So even then, with just my 2 years in JKD with Sifu Dan, that statement kind of resonated with me, because I had found that certain drills in the Kali, right, allowed you to experiment, to go down certain avenues, and then maybe drop them, right, and pick up something else. And then, you know, even like go down the weapons route and try it out, and then see if you could take the what you did in the weapons and transfer it to the empty hands. But then in the sparring, you kind of had to burn right from the start, right? In the sparring, you can't really, you know, try to go down this avenue and jettison it, because you might end up on the receiving end of something, right? So working it out in drilling is like the jazz soloist, but then working it in the sparring is like the rock music soloist, if you get that, right? And my association of music in Jeet Kune Do goes right from the beginning, because I started investigating jazz when I was just a little kid in the 1970s. So I was listening to people like Grover Washington and David Sanborn and what have you. Most of you on the broadcast are probably too young to even know who those guys are, right? But we had a family friend who was a professional saxophonist. And he told me one day that if I really wanted to understand what the modern jazz players were doing, that what I should do is to research who influenced them. And so I had to go back to the 1930s and the 1940s jazz, and that's how I ended up being turned on to people like Charlie Parker and Dexter Gordon and those kinds of people, right? Now, my first copy of The Art and Philosophy I got in 1983 when I started with Sifu Dan, and that was where I learned that music was an integral part of the training methodology in JKD, right? So that sounded pretty cool to me, right? On page 97 of the Art and Philosophy book, they're talking about the jazz saxophonist Pharoah Sanders, right? And there's a thing where it says, "I don't see the horn anymore. I am trying to see myself." And all of that, all of what I try to do in music comes back to my conviction that if you have the discipline, you can do whatever you want to. You yourself are the key to the universe. And what the conclusion was, that it was that Bruce Lee would agree with a statement like that because he was a firm believer in the liberating powers of artistic expression, right? Which is a thing that we talk about in JKD all the time, right? Okay, so this is where we'll get really, really weird. I conducted an experiment. On my blog a few years ago, you could probably find it somewhere. If anybody's interested in reading it in its original form, send me an email to jkdrebel@gmail.com and I can tell you where to go check the blog. But here's what I wrote in the blog, right? So you got to listen carefully and then see it, because as I say all the time, not all my experiments are successful. And today's broadcast is one of those experiments, all right? So here's what I wrote. At this point, Bruce Lee is my favorite martial artist, period. I understand his art so intimately that for me, it's not even about a style, but conjuring a spirit that at any moment I can call upon to walk through me, right? So that's the start of what I wrote, right? So indulge me again. I got to go into this a little bit more. I've dealt with the idea of being influenced by this person, but I feel I'm in a space where my voice has developed so much that I don't feel haunted by Bruce's ghost. I can be free to create and use whatever part of his spirit when it's necessary, and other times magnify certain things that are not necessarily directly related to Bruce. So I wrote that, and I asked people to tell me at what point in his JKD evolution did they think that Dan Inosano would have written those words or spoken those words about Bruce Lee, right? So at this point, Bruce Lee is my favorite martial artist, but I feel I'm in a space where my voice has developed so much that I don't feel haunted by Bruce's ghost. I can create and use whatever part of his spirit when it's necessary, and at other times magnify things that are not necessarily directly related to Bruce, right? So here's the last part. Indulge me some more. Just a few more minutes. We're now some time away from the time he named his art, and martial art has evolved. That gives me a frame of reference that allows me to do things Bruce didn't think about doing because it was a new approach then. So I didn't necessarily feel bound by the blueprint. Whatever Jeet Kune Do meant to Bruce then, I want to be able to take that just as far as my imagination will allow, right? So if you guys want to delve into that, you could just rewind this and listen to that again. So I left the question out there for a couple days, I think it was, and then I got some responses about, oh, maybe he said it, after Bruce Lee had passed away, maybe he said it during the time this and during the time that. Whatever it was, right, here was the experiment. It was not Dan Inosano at all. It was never anything that Dan Inosano wrote or said about Bruce Lee and Jeet Kune Do. What it was, in fact, was he wouldn't refer to himself as a jazz trumpeter, so I'll call him the way he calls himself. It was postmodern New Orleans music trumpeter, a guy named Nicholas Payton. And Nicholas Payton was talking about his mentor and his inspiration in jazz music, the legendary jazz trumpeter, Miles Davis. But when I read what Nicholas Payton had written, I go, gosh, I just got to take jazz and put in Jeet Kune Do, then take Miles out and put in Bruce, and this could be something that would relate Jeet Kune Do and jazz, Bruce Lee and Dan Inosano, Nicholas Payton and Miles Davis. So it was one of my experiments being a jazz head and a drum head and what have you, right? Okay, so that was it. So to me, subjective, JKD Rebel, Dwight Woods, JKD is a lot like jazz music, right? Okay, that's it for today. Feel free to share, like, comment, ask questions. I'll review everything after posting. Sign up for notifications on both Facebook and the YouTube for when we go live. If you can pick up the recordings on the YouTube channels for both the I Love Jeet Kune Do broadcast and the Jeet Kune Do dialogues. Heads up, in about an hour and 45 minutes, I'll be back on with Diana Rathborn, right? So that's 3 p.m. Miami time for Jeet Kune Do Dialogues episode number 31, I think, with Diana. And that's it. We'll see you back here next week, regular time, Wednesday, 3 p.m. for another I Love Jeet Kune Do broadcast. Until then, you guys take care. Enjoy the weekend. Have a good one.